Thank you for coming. This is my first time here at the expo. So this is really nice to see such a big turnout. That's pretty cool, you know, to see people of the community come out and get prepared for hurricane season, which already started. And you might know or may not know, but I started at WPTV at the beginning of the year in January. I do the mornings. So very early in the morning, if you wake up with us, tune in to WPTV. And I was born and raised in Miami, technically Kendall. So I'm a South Florida girl, a Kendall girl. And I did work in the Miami market for about 8 years. I worked at WPLG, the ABC affiliate, which is Channel 10 down in Miami. And before coming here, I was at Channel 4, the CBS station. So I'm, as growing up in South Florida, I know what it is to go through tropical storms, like many of you, but then we also have new residents that might have never gone through hurricane season, and this might be their first time, so it's good to do things like this, head out to expos, and also do your own research, look up your evacuation zone if you live in one, and also, you can look up our hurricane guide too on WPTV.com. Look for the hurricane tab or hurricane guide tab and click on that. But very important to get a head start just because we've seen it in the past time and time again, especially once we get into August, late August and September, these systems just fire up really quick. And it was very active, to say the least, since 2020. So we are hopefully not going to be as active, but we'll see. We'll see what happens. So right now, I'm waiting for James. We're going to show you a presentation. Okay. Well, yeah. I'd rather wait for. Yeah. Thank you. Here he is. James Whelan, everybody. You want to take?
Thank you. Sorry, we're looking for a clicker, so I don't have to say next every 2 seconds to get through here. But thank you all for coming. You guys already met Jennifer Correa, our newest member of the WPTV weather team. We're glad to have her here, right? You gave a little intro, very nice. So she's going to help me out today, and we're going to have a little hurricane talk since hurricane season just started. We already have our A-named storm under our belt because it didn't really bother us. And it will continue to die on out and push down to the south. I don't know if it's a depression yet, but it's going in that direction. So, very short-lived storm. We get a bunch of those every year now, too. But we'll talk about this year's hurricane season, maybe the factors involved, and explain a little bit on why the outlook, the forecast for a near normal or even below normal season, why that's the case, and explain a little bit of the science behind that. So just real quick about myself here. I've been 25 years in the business, 16 years at WPTV. April 9th, I think, was my, thank you. Was my anniversary. I can't believe it myself, honestly. You know, it was great. And what got me interested in the weather is in high school, I started surfing. And what I just wanted to know, like, what makes waves? Well, the weather makes waves. Huh. Well, now I want to know about the weather because I want to know about the next time I could go surfing. So I grew up down here in South Florida. I went to Coconut Creek High School. I went to Broward Community College, FAU, and then I went up to Florida State to get my degree, my meteorology degree at Florida State. And the fellow Seminole here is really great. Usually we don't get them, so it's nice to have a fellow Seminole here. Anybody Seminoles? Come on. All right, good. A couple, good. But, a lifelong passion, the surfing, and surfing ties in with the weather. And most surfers, too, are very tied in and cued in with the weather because we're sitting out there bobbing up and down in the middle of whatever, and we get to experience the weather as a whole. And that's kind of what is the draw of surfing, too, is being out in Mother Nature, being out in the weather and on the ocean and seeing everything out there. And I was very passionate about that. If you can click it here to the next one. There I am. That's on Palm Beach there. So I love it. So now we're coming down off of the surf season. We got summer flatness here. So you go to the next one here. And there's our whole team. We have 7 people now, one of the largest weather teams in the area. We have Katia and John and Jennifer, of course, Steve. He may come later. I talked to him last night. Steve, the other Steve, Stevie V, we call him. And Kate, of course, is going to be on tonight. So thank you all for at least watching us here and coming out to this. All right, so hurricane season just started, June 1st through November 30th, but of course, a storm can form pretty much any month of the year, and we've had them form any month of the year, too. And in fact, this January, we had a subtropical storm form. They went back in post-analysis, and they found that this storm, and I remember seeing it, too. I don't know if you remember. It looked just like a hurricane out there, but that it was off of Hatteras and the Delmarva there, and it kind of moved off, and it got some tropical characteristics. So they went back and said, okay, that's number one. So that's why we started with TD number 2, is because we already had one. It didn't get a name. They don't go back and give it a name. They just call it the unnamed subtropical storm. So that's what that was, and that's why we still get Arlene. All right, we'll go to the next one here. Last year was average with the storm numbers, but below average with the ACE. And ACE is basically if you add up all the tropical energy in the Atlantic Basin, it goes by the storms, how long they last, how big they are, how much area they cover, all that kind of stuff, kind of to simplify it, gets down into a number, and that number was below average last year. I think it was like 75-ish or so. So this year, we'll see what happens. Okay, next. All right, we have 14 named storms, 8 hurricanes, 2 major hurricanes. Like I said, that's near average, but again, you combine it with the ACE and you get it slightly below. Some notable storms, of course, we had Ian and Nicole both rode over Florida, right? We also had Tropical Storm Alex that developed after Florida. Thank you. Clicker! That developed after it moved over Florida. I don't know if you remember that one. It was very early on in the season. It came from the Gulf, moved over the state, and then once it exited the state, it became Tropical Storm Alex. And then we had Colin, too, that kind of just moved right into the Carolinas. Let's see if I can figure this out. Yay! I love it. Okay, so here are the numbers from our most reputable sources, which is Colorado State. Dr. Klotzbach took over for Dr. Gray, very smart guy, very down-to-earth guy, too. He's pretty cool to talk to. And then the NOAA forecast. And you can see they're about the same. Dr. Klotzbach is forecasting 13 named storms. He's saying it's going to be about 80% of average, the season in general. And NOAA, they extend out a little bit. So CSU is a little bit on the lower end of NOAA's forecast there. And you can see the average is about average, if not slightly below average for this year. So why is that? What are the factors that we look at for long-term outlooks like this? Well, a negative impact is El Nino. So the past 3 years, we had La Ninas, right? Now we have an El Nino, and that has been known to really put a hamper on the hurricane activity, right? Like, La Nina really doesn't do a whole lot either way. It doesn't enhance it or anything, but it doesn't put a negative impact either. El Nino definitely puts a negative impact. It's just the warming of the ocean waters in the Pacific. It's really far away, and you think, well, why does that matter? Well, it produces upper-level shear over the Caribbean, which pretty much shut down the Caribbean altogether for the whole season, and then also in the main development region of the Atlantic, too. So shear is just very strong winds that are higher up in the atmosphere. So storm wants to grow, right? It's growing from low to high. That warm air is rising. But if it constantly has wind pushing it over, it's never gonna form into a big, strong storm, right? It constantly gets pushed like a bully, constantly gets pushed, and it's never gonna grow into something big. So that's what that shear does, is puts the kibosh on any kind of big development. Doesn't mean there's gonna be zero, because there's gonna be times where there isn't shear, and there's going to be areas of the Atlantic where there isn't shear, but in general, when you add it all up, it means less storms, and it suppresses that activity. Now, we have to counteract that. A positive impact is much warmer than normal Atlantic water temperatures. So we all know that the warm water is the fuel for the storms, right? So you got a bunch of fuel out there for these storms really to get going. So that's a positive. If something gets going in a low shear environment, the possibility is there for a strong storm to develop. And we also have an above normal West African monsoon. That's just basically the tropical waves that are coming off the coast of Africa, right? But this is kind of a positive and a negative, because a more active monsoon season, yes, that's more tropical waves, but those monsoons have a lot of wind with them. They kick up a lot of that dust, that Saharan dust, and in turn, we could have a lot of the Saharan dust. The Saharan dust suppresses the activity. So that's like a drying effect, like a sponge. It's soaking up any of those tropical waves that go in. So that's kind of a plus and a negative. All right, here are our names for this year. Arlene, so we can check mark that off. Doop. Brett will be the next one here and expected to get through. So 21 is not what we're expected to get through. Hopefully we don't get quite there. So that's the list for this year. That's the primary list. And then, of course, decided a few years ago, instead of using that Greek alphabet, well, they have supplemental lists like this one here, and if a name comes on here and it happens to be a particularly destructive one, it's easier for them to retire one of those names and then replace it with something else. And honestly, all the Greek letters, like, they all sound the same. So it was hard to communicate eta, beta, and all of those things sounded the same. So when 2020, 2021, we used those, and they all kind of sounded the same. So that was a negative. So I'm glad that they changed it to that. So here's the Atlantic waters. These are the temperature anomalies. So departure from normal. So you see a lot of orange on there, right? That means warm. So there's a lot of warm water pretty much everywhere in the Atlantic, maybe a little bit normal or below in the far eastern main development region, but for the most part, there's a lot. And cooler up here is kind of bad too. If we have cool over warm, that promotes lifting here in the main development region, which when you get lifting, you get more storms to form. So that's one of the positive ones. And then the negative one is El Nino, right? So this is El Nino. This is an El Nino signature. We're already seeing it. It's not officially declared El Nino yet, but I think June is when they're going to... Yeah. It's really close. Like, we are almost there. They take like a 90-day average or something like that. But I think, you know, now that we're in June, it's going to be, I think we have an El Nino watch, so there's that. But I think it's going to be that. So again, this warmer water here along the equator in the Pacific produces an upper level shear that comes, so here's the Caribbean here, so there's gonna be shear running through that, and that's what tears apart the storms there and doesn't allow them to form. El Ninos in general occur every 2 to 7 years. For us in the winter, there's a big effect, and it means it's a cooler, wetter winter. The jet stream dips a little south. There's more storm systems coming through. Sometimes we get that split flow, too, that comes right out of California, and then another one up to the north. So it's just kind of an unsettled winter for us. Minimum impact in the summer, except for, of course, what we just talked about here, is the decreased activity in the tropics. Strong shear, of course, like we just said, kills the development. Here's the forecast. I took this a few days ago, but it's basically the same. You see that, I mean, we're almost up. So 0.5 would be technically the El Nino. And notice some of the models have a super Nino coming way up here, and we'll have to see what that is. You know, I was reading somewhere that this has never happened yet, so they don't really know. There's a lot of there's not a lot of confidence in this forecast, because we haven't had a very warm Atlantic and an El Nino happening at the same time to compare, because that's most of what seasonal forecasts are, is you look back to the past and say, well, what happened when these conditions were there last time, and then you can go by that. So we'll have to see. And you can see here, well, the red bars indicate the El Nino, and it looks like they're going to be up there and maybe coming down a little bit over the winter, but not much. I think this El Nino will stick around through the winter. All right, the AMO. So I'll read this to you. Scientific studies point to the Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation. I know that sounds all complicated. It just means it's a trend up and down and up and down, that this cycle of storms, so we get a lot more storms, we get a lot less hurricanes, a lot more hurricanes, a lot less hurricanes, and it runs about 20 to 40 years of warm and cool phases of that. And right now, well, we've been in kind of the active one, right? It's been quite a while. Warmer sea surface temperatures, increased thunderstorm activity, and the changes in wind speed. So we've gone through time here, and you can see back in the 1800s, we had a ton of hurricanes out there. And then we dip a little bit down, and then we got active again in the 40s to the 70s. And then we went down in the 70s to the 90s. There wasn't a whole lot of action here. And then we go way up here as we get into the 2000s, even off the map of this, but that we've gone up in activity. Now, it could last 10 years, it could last 20 years, but the thinking now is we may be on the decline. And last year, 1 year doesn't make it, but in general, if the activity is decreasing, we might be coming out of that. Another big factor, like we talked about, is that African dust, right? So the Saharan dust gets kicked up by these tropical waves, right? And in the beginning of the season, there's a lot of it out there. June, July especially, that's our African dust months, where all of this comes off of Africa and it makes it all the way across the Atlantic. We can see it on satellite images, especially the new GOES satellites look really good. It's just dry, warm air in the mid-upper levels of the atmosphere, and it just treks all the way across the Atlantic. And you can see into the Caribbean. The Caribbean, they get the brunt of it most of the time, but by the time it gets to us, it either splits to the north or sometimes goes to the south. But this is what it looks like, and we've seen this here in South Florida for extreme ones, too, where this is like a clear day right here. I think this is Puerto Rico. And then this is the hazy day where it's just, everything looks white, right? Like it's just white. And that, of course, suppresses the activity of any hurricanes. It's like a sponge. It's so dry that it just soaks up any kind of moisture that comes on in. Oh, good, you got a mic. You want to talk about the regions here?
Yeah, so let's go over where you get the typical formation by month. So in June, which we are now, typically you could see some formation. It shouldn't be too active, though, over the Gulf of Mexico, maybe also parts of the northwestern Caribbean. That's because if we're still getting some of these weak fronts coming down, they kind of stall out right over North Florida or the Gulf Coast. And what happens is they're very weak, but typically on these boundaries, you get these little lows, these disturbances usually popping up in the mid-levels, upper levels, and eventually it could become something, a circulation at the surface. And that's kind of, I feel like that's what we just saw with our Tropical Depression 2 and now Arlene, if it's still Arlene.
Yeah.
But look at August, September, October. That's peak hurricane season, especially
all
September.
Over the place.
You see activity
anywhere.
Forming anywhere. Yeah. That's because, you know, it takes time. Like, you know, when you turn on your bath or your shower, it doesn't turn hot right away, right? Even though you turn it all the way to hot, it takes time for the sea surface temperatures to heat up. And mind you, they're already above average, or they're very warm right now. And so as we get deep into summer months by August, especially September, that's when they're at the hottest sea surface temperatures, and in the Gulf too, especially.
Yeah, all the conditions are ripe here. It takes a little bit to get going, but yeah, that's why, you know, August, and we peak in September. And then November, they get shunted off into the Atlantic because the cold fronts are coming.
And there's like a second peak in October.
Yeah.
We've had Superstorm Sandy was in October.
Yeah.
So.
Here's the peak here, and you see September 10th. This is just how the activity just increases and then peaks and goes through. But really, say mid-August to mid-October, if you want to just boil it down to the most active time, that's the most active time. And like we were saying, there's a lot that happens after the peak too. And in fact, for South Florida, after the peak, 60% of landfalling hurricanes in South Florida happened after the peak. So just because we're kind of over that peak doesn't mean you gotta lay your guard down, because most of our stuff happens after that anyways. All right, the steering currents, that was Irma, remember that?
Yeah.
It went up this way here. It didn't even hit us directly, but boy, it caused a mess everywhere. There were palm fronds through Thanksgiving. All right, so we have the big Bermuda high, we call this, the big high out there. So there's three different scenarios. You have the weak one here, and that's when the storms, we call them fish storms. They stay out to sea. They don't come anywhere near us. Of course, a little bit of stronger one, it gets steered a little bit closer to us, maybe the Carolinas or so. So as these highs fluctuate, the storms are going around the base of these highs. These are like big mountains out there, right? So the storm can't go up and over the mountain. It has to go around the edge of that high. So the high is constantly moving. The storm is constantly moving. That's why forecasting is difficult to these storms, because everything is in motion. But when we have a really strong one, it can either go towards us, it can go into the Caribbean and then into the Gulf of Mexico, depending on the strength of the storm there. Of course, the Saffir-Simpson scale, we talk about this all the time, right? Category 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 here. And just we've had a bunch of fours here with Ian, Irma, Maria, and then 5, the latest one, Dorian, but Andrew too, if anybody remembers that. I was down here, I lived in Broward County, and yeah, it was crazy. It was a very compact storm, thank goodness.
Andrew was the reason why I got interested in science, basically. I was very little, I was 5, but let me tell you, I lived in Kendall, and that wind,
wow.
In my mind, I thought it was days. It was, that sound, I never want to hear it again. But Andrew did definitely make an impact on me and a lot of us in South Florida.
Yeah, isn't it crazy how the weather like has an impact on even the rest of your life, because it inspires you to do things like it did for us. All right, some notable storms. This is Irma, remember that. Dorian sat in the Bahamas here. A lot of people ask that question. At our weather watcher meter, people ask, well, what happened here? Because one day the models had it coming straight into Palm Beach County, and then the next day, not so much. Well, just the steering currents over it just collapsed, and it didn't have enough momentum to keep going, so it stalled there, and the Bahamas had to wait for the next. The troughs is kind of what brings it up. It's kind of like a gutter, right? It's going to roll into the lower point in the atmosphere. So it had to wait for that. So it sat there and waited, and it actually took a little while for that trough to come. But as you know, it sat there for a little bit and really caused a lot of damage there to the Bahamas. This is some of the damage there on Abaco, which was crazy. Harvey, remember that was the big rainmaker in Texas. Another example of steering currents just collapsing. So that thing made landfall. It was in central Texas, I think, and then it just meandered up and then just sat there because there were just no steering currents. So that's an example of Dorian would have went over us and stopped there. I mean, it would have been just catastrophic. There's all the flooding there in parts of Houston. Andrew, of course, there. We talked about that. There it is. And that was definitely a crazy storm. Mm-hmm. And what's also crazy is, you know, you look back and I don't, maybe I'm old, but I don't feel like it's that long ago. And the technology of the satellite images are just the amazing change that we've gone through the years of technology.
A lot of progress.
I mean, I wish, like, if we could have saw Andrew with the technology we had today, it would have been amazing.
Yeah.
And there's some of the destruction that Andrew did. So storms, of course, very serious storms. Labor Day hurricane, this is the one that knocked the railroad cars off the tracks there in the Keys. And a lot of people died from that. This is Camille. If you remember, that was the Gulf Coast one where you had the apartment building and then it was gone, an entire apartment building. So that is a good example of storm surge, because this is the beach right here. So this was right on the water. So the storm surge is what you want to get away from. So you run from surge and you hide from the wind. If you can hunker down in your house and you have a strong house that can withstand, you're not supposed to evacuate, you hunker down. You leave the evacuation to the people necessary, either along the coast or the rivers. It's not just right on the coast. Up here you have the rivers coming through, and the surge can push way up into the rivers, and then also mobile homes and weaker type homes. But it's not always hurricanes. Tropical storms cause a lot too of tornadoes. This was Tropical Storm Faye in 08. I remember that one. And then Isaac in the acreage, like Western Palm Beach County was just, it was 24 inches in like 24 hours. It was absolutely nuts. We had one band that sat over top of us and just stayed there for like a couple of days. So, and then that spawned tornadoes too. So we want to talk about the different quadrants of the hurricane here. So the strongest quadrant here is the front right. So when you look at it like this, you're like, well, I don't really understand. So let's twist it to what it normally would look like coming at us, right? So that northern, western side of the storm, as far as if it's coming straight at us, that will be the strongest storm. Everybody that, if you see the storm track coming like this, if you're up here, this is where you really, really need to take it seriously and evacuate and listen to your emergency managers. We don't call the evacuations, yeah. Your emergency managers do, and you have to listen to them and leave if necessary. Do you want to go over a watch and warning?
Oh, yes. So it's very important to know the difference between a watch and a warning. Simply, to keep it simple, the watch is possible, right? You think possible. Be alert, be aware. A warning means that it's coming or it's happening. But basically, a hurricane watch will be issued 48 hours before tropical storm force winds arrive or hurricane force winds arrive. So that 48 hours, you know, that's the time to basically put up your shutters if it's the type of storm like Cat 1 that calls it or higher. It is also the time you want to take to wrap your preps, basically. You don't want to do it in a warning. So a warning could be issued, it will be issued 36 hours in advance. However, of course, this is all based off estimated time of arrival for some of us, depending on, you know, which way the storm is coming from and where you live. That 36 hours might be a little shorter. So the warning is basically letting you know, get ready, hurricane conditions are going to be here at least within that time or less. And during the hurricane warning, really, we don't recommend doing your preps because you should have done them during the hurricane watch, right? And I know there have been times where these storms develop right offshore. So, you know, of course, sometimes it's just like rush and go and it's very stressful, but know the difference. So watch means it's possible. Warning means it's coming or it is happening.
All right. Very good. One more thing. All the weather events are local, so you want to listen to your local people, us, your local emergency managers, everybody local, tuning in to national news and all that. They're just hyping up the storm, right, because they want people to watch. So, you know, you're going to have your family, your friends, your kids calling you, oh, my God, you're going to get destroyed. You know, just listen to us. They're going to do that, you know, but the real information for your local people. We live here too. We know what to do. We got your back. That's why we're here. And you want to listen to local people too for anything going on. Have your family plan out there too. You can go online and get this. You want to do all of these preps here. I'll just quickly go through it because we're running out of time. But you go through all these preps ahead of time, so you don't have to deal with like craziness later on. You know, everybody rushing to the store to get water. Like, it's easy to get water right now, right? When nobody's rushing to the store. You want to get that. Of course, gas, you know, we've had problems with gas. I mean, what's the use of getting gas a week out? You're going to need it again down the road. So, I mean, there's that. There's certain things you can prepare for and certain things you can't. Here's our weather pilot that's right out front. This is old school weather radio and then the new school cell phone app. You want to be, you want to think ahead of how am I going to charge my cell phone? Of course, your car can do that, but you have to think maybe more than that too. A little bit more Mophies, maybe a solar. I bought a solar charger, yeah. And have that just in case. And again, thank you guys so much for coming out here. Thank you for watching. Follow us on Instagram. I'm at Surfing Weatherman. Follow me there. I'm going to post everything on there. And Jennifer also is on there and all of the whole weather team.